This for sorry. I'll turn it.
After that beautiful presentation in music, so I will also share a song. He can turn the tides and calm the angry sea. He alone decides who rights a sinful need. He lights every star that makes our darkness bright. He keeps watch all through its long and lonely night. He still finds the time to hear a child's first prayer. Saint or sinner, call and always find him there. Though it makes him sad to see the way we live, he'll always say, I forgive. He can grant the wish or make a dream come true. He can paint the clouds and turn the gray to blue. He alone knows where to find the rainbow's end. He alone can see what lies beyond the bend. He can touch a tree and turn the leaves to gold. He knows every lie that you and I have told. It makes him sad to see the way we live. He'll always say, I forgive. Though it makes him sad to see the way we live, he'll always say,
and the pandemic hit, so we're not able to travel for a few years. And praise the Lord for the Thai government have opened it already last July 1, so we're able to travel. And you can also visit Thailand now, no problem. So that will be a great blessing. And again, thank the pastor, his wife, and the congregation, and also, we'd like to thank the family. I don't know if I need to mention their name, but we have a beautiful place. we can rest for a few days. Amen. Thank you very much. It's we enjoy it. And so, thank you. We are in a place called heaven. So, praise the Lord. And of course, Sister Heidi and her family. Sister Heidi is my classmate in seminary in 1986. So, if I mention that year, it means she's old and I'm old. No? her sister, her older brother, me, and another guy, we have been classmates and studied in the Bible Baptist Seminary in our city. And I got saved through an American missionary. Directly, he shared the gospel to me February of 1983. And so when I got saved, and also my wife and her family got saved through the ministry that also started by an American missionary. But she's from the southern part, and I'm from the northern part of the Philippines. And December 11, 1985, I surrendered my life. I said, Lord, here's my life. Use me. And so by June 17, 1986, supposed to be I'm enrolling in a university. I went to the university to enroll to, because my, I want to be a lawyer, not liar, lawyer. Yeah. And is this the same here? But the university have closed the that course. They turned it into a medical university, and so instead of enrolling there, I went straight to the seminary and enrolled in June 17, 1986. And after finishing the seminary, I worked with American missionary, and then in 1992 I started a church in one of the oldest Catholic town in our province, and that church is still there, thriving, and praise the Lord. And so from 1992 to 99, the Lord has allowed me to start three churches. So one in our home city, and then I went farther north, and then the last one is in Metro Manila near the international airport. Good ministry. And then in 1999, November, my pastor brought me to Thailand, and I am thinking that he would talk to me, that he would be in the foreign mission, and I would go home in Angeles City, my hometown, to pastor our church. But in 3 days, the Lord changed it. So the Lord just burdened my heart. Now, I don't know what his foreign mission is. I know I've been serving the Lord in the Philippines as a church planter. And I have three churches planted, and they're all, by God's grace, still to this day, thriving ministry. And so I came back after our visit to Thailand. We pray a little bit because, you know, it's a different ball game. This is Thailand. I don't know the language. I don't know the food. It's different. Different culture, different country. That's hard for us. So I talked to my wife, and she said, let's pray about it. We pray about it. And so by December, wherever the Lord leads, she says, let's go. So by the end of December, I resigned from my work, my pastoral work in Paranaque City, and then also from my work. I am not a licensed lawyer. I did not take a bar or finish the course, but I work also in a law firm. And by doing that, I also started the church. That's the work that I'm doing. And by God's grace, as I resigned from all of that work, we prepare ourselves for a few months, and then we went to Thailand and served the Lord there. So we went to the foreign mission with about $600, and we just went there and rented a small apartment, $150, and so we live by the $350 or $450. So I don't know if it will be enough. And so we have to leave the country every 28 days because we have no missionary work permit yet. And so that take all the money that you have. But the Lord is so gracious because I believe when God calls, He provides. Amen. You see, if worry can add days in your life, then worry. Right? If worry would bring peace in your life, then worry. But I read my Bible, it won't. But trusting God will supply all the things. So that's what we experience. The Lord has provided until, you know, little by little, the Lord provided for us. We have pastor friends who came to Thailand. They see what we're doing. and also was given privilege to come here back in the U.S. in 2002. I met pastor, went to Ravenna at the time, and the Lord blessed. And so we're able to continue. In 22 years, the Lord has allowed us to plant 5 churches. Amen. One in the south side of Bangkok from 2000 to 2003, and then 2000. This, you see in the picture, Grace Baptist Church, that was organized on October 5, 2003. Start from zero, nothing. And the Lord has blessed that ministry. We have a property paid for, church building, and all of the people that attends there used to be Buddhists, and now they worship the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. And through this ministry also, we're able to help start another church in the northeast side of Thailand. It's about 4 hours drive, and they have also church property there given by a member, and we have about 60 people attends the church. When tsunami struck the southern part of Thailand, we're able to help the people there. It's a Muslim place, but the Lord has blessed us. We're able to establish Grace Baptist Church there also. Amen. Now they have a Thai pastor. Then coming back, the Lord has allowed us again. There is an American missionary who went back to California, and they have an English school, and he called me if I would like to continue. I said, well, if you give it for me for free, I'll continue. But no, I have to pay $6,000 to all of the documents. So we continue that work, but by God's grace, we're able to start Grace Baptist Church through that ministry also. Not only that we're able to start Grace Baptist Church, but we were able to start orphanage in Chiang Rai, the northern part of Thailand. This is the border of Laos and Myanmar or Burma. And the Lord has blessed us. We have 16 children that we help there. And so praise the Lord. We call it God's home for abandoned children. And so we praise the Lord for the churches and individuals who have supported us and help us. Some would give $25 a month, $50, so we're able to supply the needs of these children. And now we are on our 6th church plant on about northern side of Thailand, of Bangkok, 2 hours drive. And there is no church there, no Christian church or whatsoever. There is no Seventh-day Disadvantages. There is no Jehovah's Witnesses there. There is no. There is a Catholic cemetery, but there is no Catholic church. All you will see are those Buddhist temples everywhere. Just drive maybe 5 minutes, 10 minutes, you will see Buddhist temples everywhere in that country. Why? Because it's a Buddhist country, right? Thailand is the only country that never been colonized in Southeast Asia. Malaysia has been by the British, and even the Singapore. Laos is France, and Cambodia, Philippines is Spain, but Thailand never colonized. And the only the Baptist church in Southeast Asia, the first Baptist church, is organized in Thailand, Bangkok, Thailand, in 1887. Before, there a Baptist missionary came in the Philippines in 1900. So the Baptist now is in the Philippines for 122 or 23 years. And by God's grace, the Baptist, every second Thursday of the month of January, starting next year, every second Thursday of the month of January, there will be a special non-working holiday because in recognition of Baptist Day, signed by the president and it's by the law. It's not by constitution, it's not by, by command or, what's the word of that word? No, Oh, it's okay. But anyway, it's by the law, signed by the president. Amen. So praise God for American missionary. Now it's recognized in the Philippines. Amen. Because churches like you have sent missionaries in our country. And in our sixth church plant, in that province or city, the population is 2 million. There's a couple, old couple. Sometimes it's hard to say, you know, they get offended, but we will get there anyway. So they're 89 years old. They approached me and they said, Pastor, we have no money, because they are just, you know, farmer. A farmer in Thailand is not like the farmer here. So, but they said they have a piece of land. We would like to give this to the church. And our dream is to see a church building here where people could come and worship the true God. So last April, the title of the property is now transferred to the church name. We did all of the documents. The size of the property is double the size of this church building, not including your parking lot, just this church building here. So it's a good piece of land that they gave us. So that's our dream, that one day, by God's grace, by the first quarter of next year, we can start building that. And we pray that the Lord will bless us with $50,000, because when we make plan everything, the line of the electric and the raising up the land, all will be $50,000. Of course, the one who's going to work will be me and the men in the church. We will not get contractor, or else it will be more than that. But with that $50,000, when we started sharing it to churches, to our supporting churches, the Lord has blessed us already with more than $30,000. We are just in need of $18,250. Amen. After this meeting, if you have $250, at least I am just $18,000 away. Amen. But if you have $18,250, I'll go home tomorrow. Yeah. But the reality is, we would like to go home. Please do pray for us. We would like to go home on November 30. That's our flight. And by God's grace, somebody paid our, there's a church who made an offering, and so we can pay now the change of our flight. Because supposed to be, we'll go home on February, but that will take too long. So we just pray for 3 months, and hopefully we could reach our goal of new churches that will be able to partner with us, supporting us as missionary in Thailand to reach the people of Thailand, and help us build the dream of that old couple who gave their land, so we can build a church building, a church where people could come. You see the Grace Baptist Church building? We are surrounded by 8 big Buddhist temples. You see all those Buddhist temples in the video? We are in the middle of that. We are the only Baptist church there. Only. Here you travel just 5 minutes, Baptist here, Baptist there. To this date, there are only 35,000 independent Baptist churches. Pastor, you went there to Thailand. But to this date, that we know of. But if there are 135 Baptist, independent Baptist, what did I say? Huh? 3,000? All right, 35 independent Baptist churches. But if there are 100 Baptist churches, if there are, with 50 members, so that would put you what? 5,000 Baptist people with 70 million in population. That's the reality. You'd go to Thailand. And you would say, why is it hard? Is there persecution? No. You are protected there. If you have a missionary work permit, you're protected by the law. No persecution. You will, you will not face any of that. But the thing is, we have a Thai person right here. They were just like a little child. They are already trained to follow the rituals and pray, just like this. And it's every day. Every day. They do that every day. You know how much they spend every day to offer to their temple or to the monk? $12. And you know how much they earn every day? Most of them, $25. Wow. That's every day. You wonder why it's hard to reach. And here, we've been blessed in this country, but the saddest part is that parents, instead of bringing their children to come to church and worship the Lord, they would bring their children to play sports. Thinking that if they learn more, they can play more or good in baseball or football, they can earn millions. You may gain the wealth of this world, but if you lose your soul, you gain nothing. Profiteth nothing. Amen. I might be poor, but I'm rich in Christ. Amen. That would be a great blessing. To them, Buddhism is not religion, it's their way of life. Supposed to be Christianity is not religion, it should be our way of life. But it becoming just a ritual or religion to a lot of people. 70 million people and 1% so-called Christians, that is according to the Department of the Religious Affairs in Thailand, 1 million. 1 million only of the 70 million. That includes Catholic and other Christianity as they claim to be. That's the reality of that country. That's why I said, Lord, are you going to... I'm enjoying my ministry in the Philippines. I like it there. I don't have to learn the language. I don't have to learn to eat the food. Amen. Everything is, the only thing, the good thing in the Philippines ministry, if you don't have support, you can ask chicken and your neighbor, they will give it to you with papaya. With the papaya is what it's with vegetable. So they will, no problem, they care. But you go in the foreign land, it's different ball game. But praise God, the Lord is so gracious in us. And with all of the experience, with the struggle that we went through as missionaries, financially, emotionally, the Lord has been so gracious to us that we're able to survive 22 years and counting. I said to my wife, I think I need to go home now in the Philippines. I will continue to study the jurisprudence, and then I'm going to be in, I will follow my calling before to go to politics. And one day I'll be the president. Not of the country, but of our village. But we praise God, amen, that we can continue to serve the Lord. And we will do so continually. And, even during the pandemic, the Zoom meeting, we were able to establish a church in the Philippines. We have now 70 people. I did a Bible study every day, 6 in the morning, for 2 years. And now we have Calvary Baptist Church. Well, amen. So just a few minutes. Don't worry. I know you are all hungry now. At least you understand our ministry in Thailand. And, you hear the pastor preach Sunday upon Sunday, Wednesday upon Wednesday, and you are filled with the Word of God. And so this one is just a reminder to us in Luke chapter number 4, in verse number 41, the devil also came out of many crying out and saying, Thou art Christ, the Son of God. And he, rebuking them, suffered them not to speak, for they knew that he was Christ.
And when it was day, he departed and went into a desert place, and people sought him and came unto him and stayed him, and he should not depart from them. And he said unto them, this is Jesus Christ telling them, he said, I must preach the kingdom of God to other cities also, for therefore am I sent. And he preached in synagogue, in the synagogues of Galilee. So you see here, the Lord Jesus Christ, his first concern is right here, that I must preach the kingdom of God. During this pandemic, the government leaders, they would say, or the scientists, or the people in the medical world, they say, we are now going to live in a new normal. I don't know what is a new normal is. Amen. But I believe it's still the same. People are still sinners. They need the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. And during the most affected ministry or work during this pandemic is the ministry of the church. You know, there's one thing that this pandemic created. People would say pandemic, but in my opinion, it's plandemic. I'm not to be in the politics here, but that's what I believe. You can crucify me if you want, but that's what I believe. All right? See, what happened? It creates fear, right? You observe before this pandemic, everybody just no problem at all, right? Nowadays, right? You don't want to sneeze, right? If you are in the bus, it's the same thing. The hardest part is when you are in the airplane. In the airplane, they will put you 6 meters away. Line. But when you get to the inside the airplane, it's shoulder to shoulder. Crazy, right? This is the world. Their system. They thought or they think that they have the answer of this problem, but they don't have. It's still the same. The condition of men, they are still sinners to this day. And they need the Lord Jesus Christ. And so Jesus says, I must go to those cities and preach the kingdom of God. So as a church, as you see here, striving together for the faith of the gospel, amen? And go ye into all the world, because I believe in my heart there is never changing normal as Jesus see the condition of the lost people. As Jesus looked unto the multitude, he was moved with compassion. I think that's what happened to me. When our tour guide, our Filipino, he said, Brother Gutla, if you look into that valley, 87,000 families, there is no gospel witness. Oh, that was 22 years. I just stepped back, sat in a big rock, and cried like a baby. I really don't know what happened to me at that time. What I know is I'm serving God in our country. I am enjoying it. I have Bible study everywhere. I would have Bible study to the military officers, to lawyers, medical doctors. I will go to the hospital and do Bible study to all of these high-ranking people. I would go to their offices. As a matter of fact, one of the generals there in the Philippines, he would give me something and so I could put gasoline in my vehicle for free. Because I would go there and would teach in the camp. I would go from camp and camp, you would see the high-ranking officers, and I would preach to them the gospel. But why would I go to a country where I don't know anybody there? But I have to go because the condition of those people, they worship a dead God. Their God have ears but cannot hear, have hands but can't move, have feet but it can't move. The God that they worship is a dead God, and there is no hope. Where in the Word, the God that we worship, the Lord Jesus Christ, is a living God. And to this day, He is alive. Amen. My Jesus is alive. My Savior is alive. My God is real. Amen. Now we are living in a world of Christianity where, how are you, brother?
Just the same yesterday.
My friend, if you are the same yesterday, you have a problem. Because every day should be a great day. We experience the grace of God. Amen? Every day. Every day. If 22 years ago or 10 years ago, the ministry I have is still one, I have a problem. I'm on my knees every 5:30 in the morning with some of the Thai men. I say, Lord, bless us here. And God bless us. Because my God is alive. Amen. Amen. See the condition of man, your neighbor, your co-worker, people that you know, even your loved ones, your children, your mother, your parent, your sister or your brother, be on your knees and cry to the Lord and say, God, save them. Amen. You will enjoy your life in heaven while your brother who is still alive have a chance to be saved, will one day will go to hell. Or your son or your daughter. My little beloved, see the world through the eyes of our Lord Jesus Christ. His concern is still those people who needs the Lord. Amen. The program of the church is still Great Commission. Amen. And I praise the Lord for this church who love missionaries. Amen. Who pray. You know, there's so many churches nowadays. As we go around, just like these people here, stay with us, Lord. Don't go. A lot of churches today, they build big buildings, but no mission. They're not reaching the world. Just like what Jesus, John wrote, Laodicean church. They say they are rich, but they're poor, right. Lukewarm. Amen. Jesus says, I will spew thee out of my mouth. Oh, I hope that our churches be like a Smyrna, a Philadelphia. A Smyrna, that you're persecuted, you have struggled. There's so much persecution that you are going through, but still, Rose Park Baptist Church, with all of the struggle, financially or whatever that may be, but you still focus on mission. And God's blessing is still there. Hallelujah. Amen. And here, he says, I must preach the kingdom of God. What is the kingdom of God? Matthew 6:33, he says, but seek ye first the kingdom of God. Right? In John chapter number 3, if you will not be born again, you will not see the kingdom of God. What is kingdom of God? Of course, it's not kingdom of heaven. Kingdom of heaven, I believe, is the literal reign of our Lord Jesus Christ. The kingdom of God, Apostle Paul, he says, kingdom of God is not meat nor drink, but it's what? Righteousness, joy, and peace. The world is in trouble without peace.
And I must preach Christ so they will have peace.
People thought that having money, they will have joy, but it's not.
Joy is only found in our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Righteousness. It's sad to say that now we are living in the world like, oh, it's just fine. It's just fine to not to be in the church. Oh, it's just fine to drink a little bit of the beer. It's just fine to just compromise a little bit. Not only that, the saddest part, what's happening around us now? The church compromise. No more choir. The light becomes dark. The stage is dark. Smoke comes out. We are no longer in the church. We are now in a place where people are, they love to be entertained. Passing through Kentucky, preacher, driving there in Winchester, that scenic road, there is a big signboard. And it says, visit our church today. We have a brand new chair. Wow. So I would go to the church because they have a brand new chair. Or I would go to the church because I'm going to worship God. I'm going to the church because I want to have peace. I want to have joy. I want to learn the word of God so I can learn to live a righteous life.
Amen, brother.
Never compromise our Bible. Thank God I still have my preserved word of God, the inspired word of God in my hand.
Amen.
I still use the King James Bible. Amen. Hallelujah. They say, it's hard to understand. Of course, it's God's word. Who among you here can interpret the law of Constitution of the United States, the whole? You cannot unless you learn. Amen. And it's not easy. Even the Supreme Court justice have problem to explain it. Right? You cannot even, there's even a debate in your constitutional right, the amendment number 2. Right? It's still a debate. Now, amounts more here. It's not the word of man. It's the word of Holy God. Amen.
Amen.
So it's not easy to understand. You mean to say it's hard to understand? Well, the Bible says if you have the Spirit of God, amen.
Amen.
That's why God gave, Apostle Paul says the Lord gave what? What? Prophet? But no more prophet now, amen. Apostles? It's done. What do we have now? Pastors? Teachers? Evangelist for what? For the perfecting of the saint with the word of God. So to this day, the never-changing normal is that the condition of men, they are still sinners needing the Lord Jesus Christ. And our church is still need to fulfill the great commission, whatever it takes. The last command should be our utmost.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
Again, we are so blessed. Thank you all very much for allowing us to be here. Pastor, thank you. And hopefully you'll pray for us and help us in the ministry. Thank you and God bless.
Father, we thank you, Lord, for this great challenge that we've been, Lord, that we've been challenged with. Lord, thank you for the opportunity, Lord, to learn more about this great country of Thailand, wonderful, sweet people, 70 million people, 69 million of them need the Lord, probably more. So, Father, we pray, God, we pray for the Good Life family. Thank you for their faith. Lord, their faithfulness. Thank you for their heart to leave their home and their country and the comforts, dear Lord, and the safety and security and familiarity to follow you and your call. Lord, I pray tonight, Father, and to several specifically, if there's one here tonight that is, Lord, not absolutely sure that heaven is their home, God, I pray that tonight would be the night they would put their faith and trust in Jesus. Lord, tonight, I pray if there's one here tonight, Lord, that would say that, Lord, after hearing this message, Lord, maybe you've brought conviction to their life. Lord, they've lost their passion and their zeal and their love of the Lord. And God, I pray, dear Lord, that they would, Father, rekindle the fire of love and passion and devotion in life. But Lord, maybe there's someone here tonight, maybe a younger person, maybe an older person, and maybe God is extending a call to them, the call to surrender their life, to follow the Lord into service, whatever that may be. And then Lord, I pray, Father, as you're leading in the hearts of men and women tonight, I pray that they would surrender to that. And Lord, we pray and ask for this in Jesus' name. Amen. As the musicians begin to play a verse of invitation softly, please.